president and founder of the Proud Black Buddhist World Association. We at the Proud Black Buddhist World Association practice the Buddhist teachings as taught by the 13th century Japanese sage Nichiren Shoshu. We have an exciting Buddhist lecture for you today. Our lecture is called Southside with You, a Black Buddhist lecture. Now let's talk about Southside with You. Now, Southside with You, and I'm the first to admit that I'm excited and honored to give you a Black Buddhist lecture. Those of you who have not heard of the movie Southside with You, it is a 2016 American biographical romantic drama film written and directed by Richard Tanning. In his feature film directorial debut, the film stars Parker Sawyers and Tika Sumter as a young Barack Obama and a Michelle Robinson. Please understand that this movie is a fictional creation that emerged out of the mind of Mr. Richard Tanning. Now, the line of reality and fiction is blurred in that a movie gives you a perception of something that may or may not be a reality. In the case of this Black Buddhist lecture, it will be very difficult for you to understand this lecture in regards to Buddhism, because the Buddhist religion is a perception that Buddhism is an oriental religion. But that is not true. See, Buddhism is a religion that emerged from the people who are known as Eastern Ethiopia, or Ethiopians. These people were black people. In the West, on Africa, these people were known as Nubian people. And in the East, these people were known as the Naga, or the snake or dragon people. The land that was once called Eastern Ethiopia today is known as India. Now, the word India means black. In ancient times, or in rather time of the Buddha of India, the people were black people. We have, or we can refer to, archaeological, anthropology, literary science, genetic science, and prove that the people who we call white people did not live, create, or have any evidence of ever entering what is known as the Indus Valley Civilization. What is known as India today, in the area known as Magadha, where the Buddha emerged, was once a civilization that was known as the Harappan Civilization. The Indus Valley Civilization was a Bronze Age civilization, mature period between 2600 and 1900 before the Christian era, extended from what today is northeast Afghanistan to Pakistan and northwest India, along the ancient Egypt and Mesopotamia. It was one of the three civilizations of the old world, and of the three most widespread, it flourished in the basins of the Indus River, one of the major rivers of Asia. Now, in this lecture, I present to you a Black Buddhist lecture. Now, what you have in the Buddhist religion, you do not have black people who are lecturing or teaching Buddhism, so we are unique in that circumstance. Now, there is no Asian, there is no white man or anyone in the world who is more uniquely qualified to give you a Black Buddhist lecture on the movie Southside with You. Now, the movie trailer reads, quote, based on an inspiring true story. The movie is about the first date between 28-year-old Barack Obama Jr. and 25-year-old Michelle Robinson. Now, their first date took place in Chicago in 1989. Now, the movie director Richard Taney was not born until February 4, 1985. When the Obama-Robinson date took place in 1989, Richard Taney was only 4 years old. Now, I want you to look at a picture of me in Ebony magazine. That's in June of 1983. I was listed in Ebony as one of the top 10 bachelors in America. And the reason that I bring this fact up is that I lived in 1989. I was at the Spike Lee movie myself in 1989. So in 1989, it would have been common for me to date a woman like a Michelle Obama, because I have dated attorneys. And of course, I would have dated a woman like this. So I believe that we have a greater insight into the date as opposed to a Richard Taney who wrote a fictional account of their date. Now, in 1988, Barack Obama Jr., prior to his start in law school at Harvard University, first visited Kenya. It is written, quote, "The trip to Kenya helped Barack Obama to realize the struggles that his father went through. It gave Barack Obama a sense of work that he is doing is directly connected to his Kenyan family and their struggles." Barack Obama says, quote, "The visit helped unify my outward self and my inward self in an important way," unquote. Now, in 1988, you had a 27-year-old Barack Obama Jr. starting law school at Harvard. And in 1988, you had me, Anthony F. Elmore, a Nichiren Buddhist and a world karate kickboxing champion, who wrote, produced, directed, and starred in his own independent Memphis-produced film called The Contemporary Gladiator. In 1988, I joined the ranks of black filmmakers. In 1989, Barack Obama Jr. and Michelle Robinson went to see the Spike Lee movie, Do the Right Thing. In 1986, Spike Lee released his first feature-length film called She's Gotta Have It. In August of 1986, along with the Spike Lee film, Spike Lee released a book called She's Gotta Have It, Inside Guerrilla Filmmaking. After seeing the Spike Lee movie, I enrolled in college. I took a typing course, and it was my dream or my idea to go out and be like Spike Lee and make my own movie about my own story. It's what I did. Also, in 1987, Robert Townsend released a movie called Hollywood Shuffle. Now, Hollywood Shuffle is a 1987 satirical comedy about racial stereotypes of African Americans in film and television. The film tracks the attempts of Bobby Taylor to become a successful actor and the mental and external roadblocks he encounters, represented through a series of interspersed vignettes and fantasies. Produced and directed and co-written by Robert Townsend, the film is semi-autobiographical reflecting Townsend's experience as a black actor when he was told he was not black enough for certain roles. With the Proud Black Buddhist, a black filmmaker, and would have written about the Obama-Robertson relationship from a Buddhist perspective. This lecture gives you a black Buddhist perspective and an insight into blacks who are proud, black, and Buddhist. Now, my lecture, Southside With You, is a black Buddhist lecture. My prayer and effort is to teach you Buddhism. We give you a black perspective of the Buddhist faith. Another name for Buddhism is humanism. We reject the idea of Buddhism being perceived as some Asian monk on the mountain meditating. Every time you look at Buddhism, all you see associated with Buddhism is an Asian. Now, we practice the highest teachings of the Buddha called the Lotus Sutra. Now, the Lotus Sutra is the highest teachings of the Buddha. While people may practice Buddhism, most do not practice the highest teachings of the Buddha. The highest teachings of the Buddha has nothing to do with Asians, because the highest teachings of the Buddha deals with the law of cause and effect. Now, in regards to Buddhism, it is only the Lotus Sutra that takes the Buddhist teachings out of the realm of what we call Asian cultural imperialism. It is only the Lotus Sutra that put Buddhism in a modern 21st century paradigm. The writings of Nichiren Shonen are called the Gosho. The Gosho are letters that Nichiren Shonen wrote to his disciples. The way to get a 21st century understanding of Buddhism is reading the Gosho. Now, there is a Gosho called The Gift of Rice, which reads, quote, "The true path lies in affairs of this world. The Golden Light Sutra states, quote, to have a profound knowledge of this world is itself Buddhism. It goes on further. The Nirvana Sutra states, quote, all of the non-Buddhist scriptures and writings in society are themselves Buddhist teachings and not non-Buddhist teachings. He goes on further. When the great teacher Marlo compared these passages with the one from the sixth volume of the Lotus Sutra that reads, quote, no worldly affairs of life or work are ever contrary to the true reality. He revealed their meanings and pointed out that although the first two sutras are profound, since their meanings is still shallow and fails to approach that of the Lotus Sutra. He goes on further. They relate to secular matters in terms of Buddhism, whereas the Lotus Sutra explains that in the end, secular matters are the entirety of Buddhism. Now, since the Lotus Sutra is the essence or the entirety of secular matters, and that's what true Buddhism is, then the movie Southside With You is a secular movie, and it is actually Buddhism. Now, in this Buddhist lecture, Southside With You, it is my attempt to give you a black perspective of Buddhism. This movie is perfect because it is a black movie. Let's get off into Buddhism. We who practice the correct teachings of the Buddha, Shakyamuni, follow the correct teachings of the 13th century Japanese sage Nichiren Shonen, who teaches us that we should practice chanting the title of the Lotus Sutra. The title of the Lotus Sutra is Yo-Ho-Ren-Ge-Kyo. It was Shakyamuni Buddha who first intoned or chanted Yo-Ho-Ren-Ge-Kyo. So we are clear Shakyamuni Buddha came from what was known in the time of Homer and Herodotus as Eastern Ethiopia. The Ethiopians were black people and they spoke a black language. Now, in regards to the movie, Southside with You, this is a black movie. Now the movie Southside with You is also Myoho-Ren-Ge-Kyo. We chant the words Namu Myoho-Ren-Ge-Kyo. The word Namu means to awaken. It also means to give reverence. It also means to devote one's life. Now, the word Myo means incomprehensible, unfathomable. It also means correct. It also means mystic. And it also means to open. And it also means wonderful. Now, the movie itself is what we call Ho, or a manifestation of a universal law, or the universal law of cause and effect. Now, it is only the Lotus Sutra that explains that all phenomena manifest 3,000 worlds in a momentary state of existence. Now, the word Ren represents the lotus flower or cause, and Ge represents the its manifestations. Now, the word Kyo means teachings. Now, let us bring to you an understanding of true Buddhism, or the teachings of the Buddha Shakyamuni, as taught by the 13th century Japanese sage Nichiren Shoshu. Much of what we know as Buddhism is not the Lotus Sutra or the highest teachings of Buddhism. Most people understand Buddhism as only an Asian culture or a limited aspect of Buddhist teachings. Most people understand Buddhism as a religion, whereas you have an Asian monk up on some mountain meditating. True Buddhism and the Lotus Sutra has little or nothing to do with Asian people. What is perceived as Buddhism is only one limited aspect of the Buddhist teachings, whereas one concentrates on the mind, or concentration or meditation. In regards to Buddhism, the word Buddha means wisdom. Now, let us look at the movie Southside with You from the standpoint of Buddhism or the Lotus Sutra. The Gosho or the writings of Nichiren Shoshu reads, quote, only Buddhas know the true aspect of all phenomena. The true aspect of all phenomena is Myoho-Ren-Ge-Kyo. Now, Richard Taney is a white Jewish writer, producer, and director of the film. The writers of Buddhism teaches us, quote, only Buddhas know the true aspect of all phenomena. That is, appearance, nature, entity, power, influence, inherent cause, relationship, latent effect, manifest effect, and the consistency from beginning to the end. This is called the 10 aspects or whole of how all life manifests. Now, let us break this down. We black people live in a white dominated culture. And it's rare, or we're not going to go to a movie theater and see a black, clean-cut romantic story. Because this is the story of Barack and Michelle Obama, we get the fortune to see a love story. The Lotus Sutra breaks all phenomena down in terms of the law of cause and effect. Now, it is natural that a white Jewish man emerged to tell this story. There's a history of Jewish people who grew up in the film industry, so that is a natural progression for a Jewish man or a young man to grow up and make a movie. Now, this really doesn't happen in the black community. Now, the movie or the idea of this movie came from Richard Tanning. Now, this movie was not sanctioned or collaborated by the Obamas. This is what Mr. Tanning writes, quote, "I pretty much just called from the public domain articles, interviews, videos, just whatever I could get my hands on," Tanning said. "And through the years, I have been reading as many books as possible. Of course, there wasn't a note taker on the dates, so you just have to extrapolate from what's there," unquote. Now, what you have is this Jewish man who came up with an idea of the Obama romance, and he put the idea to a movie. Now, to the average white person, I imagine that you only see the movie Southside with you as a cute love story. Now, in Buddhism, we say that is your karma as a white person in America who enjoy white privilege. Now, to me, an African American, the movie is an act of spiritual redemption. In the old days, the old folks used to say, there is a God. In life, we look for justice, or we look to right a wrong. And for myself and for others who are African American, it is so pleasurable to see African Americans in a positive role in a love story. Now, when I first heard about the movie Southside with you, I felt like old people that said, man, there's a God. Like one of the things that's very irritable, for example, to go and to look at this movie and you see an African-American perspective. Now, right now, during the time of this lecture, we are into political season, and we have political candidate Donald Trump, who makes some very disparaging remarks about black people. Let's listen to these low-down, rotten, disparaging remarks that Donald Trump makes, because this relates to this movie and the condition of African Americans. Let's listen to Donald Trump.
What do you have to lose by trying something new like Trump? What do you have to lose? I say it again, what do you have to lose? Look, what do you have to lose? You're living in poverty. Your schools are no good. You have no jobs. 58% of your youth is unemployed. What the hell do you have to lose?
We African Americans or black people do not live this apocalyptic idea where shooting and killing and we live normal lives like anybody else, and this is not the life that I live. I don't grow up in that kind of condition. Now, what is exciting about the movie Southside with You is that you have, out of Chicago, a Michelle Obama who comes from a positive environment. Now, let me tell you how this relates to Buddhism. those of you who are not familiar with the Lotus Sutra and the highest teachings of the Buddha, the Lotus Sutra is the essence of the Buddha Shakyamuni's teachings. The analogy that best describes Buddhism is the lotus flower. There are two things that are indicative of the lotus flower or the lotus plant. The flower and seed, or cause and effect. That's what it represents. Now, secondly, the lotus blooms in dirty water. See, the lotus is a most rare flower. It blooms and bears fruit at the same time. When the lotus blooms, the lotus seed appears. The lotus takes root in the mud. This is the analogy of the Lotus Sutra in the Buddhist faith. Just as the Lotus Sutra blooms in dirty water, out of life's challenges have emerged our best. Today, at the time of this lecture, Chicago is the myrtle capital of the world. However, out of Chicago or the mud emerged a Michelle and a Barack Obama. We have more hopes for our future than we have of the negative of our present reality. See, the Gosho or writings of Nichiren Shonin on attaining Buddhahood in this lifetime reads, quote, "If the minds of living beings are impure, their land is also impure. But if their minds are pure, so is their land. There are not two lands, pure or impure in themselves. The difference lies solely in the good or evil of our minds." Unquote. Now, so when we look at the movie from the perspective of Richard Tiny, we see only a great love story. Now, when we look at the story from a Buddhist perspective, we see a deeper story. When we view the movie from a Black perspective, we even see an even deeper story. Now, let me put my Black cap on for a minute. Watching Tika Sommer play Michelle Robinson allowed me to fall in love again. As a Black man in America, I had to learn how to fall in love with Black women. For example, in my particular case, when I grew up, I used to see Eddie Mae on the Beverly Hillbillies. I used to see the I Dream of Jeannie woman and Jane on Tarzan. You did not see Black women. We did not grow up seeing the beauty of Black women. The beauty and the eloquence of the Black women was not accentuated. When we would see a Black woman, we would see Aunt Jemima on a pancake box, or we'd see something, Black women in a maid suit, or very negative. But we did not see a Michelle, a Obama, a beautiful Black and elegant Black woman. So from that standpoint, the movie Southside With You gives us a look at a young Michelle Robinson, and it admits a sense of pride for us. Now, for many Black people, being Black is a culture. And for some Black people, being Black is a practice. Now, in regards to Barack Obama Jr., he was raised as an Indonesian, Hawaiian, and a white. Barack Obama Jr. had to practice being Black. In the Obama book, Dreams of My Father, President Obama writes, quote, "Away from my mother, away from my grandparents, I was engaged in a fitful interior struggle. I was trying to raise myself to be a Black man in America, and beyond the giving of my appearance, no one around me seemed to know exactly what that meant." Unquote. in regards to Buddhism in the Lotus Sutra, we understand that we live through space and time, and relationships are only a matter of karma. Karma is the sum total of cause and effect. In the movie Southside with You, Richard Taney created a superficial mortal Barack and Michelle Obama. In the words of the hood, we at the Proud Black Buddhist World Association hold that Barack and Michelle Obama relationship was not just a common occurrence, but this relationship was made in heaven. This relationship is what we call karma. Now, all one has to do is read the words of Barack Obama's white earlier girlfriend, Geneva Cook. In a Vanity Fair article, it is quoted as saying, quote, early in Barack Obama's relationship with Geneva, he had told her about his adolescent image of the perfect ideal woman and how he had searched for her at the expense of hooking up with available girls. Who was the ideal woman? Geneva conjured her in her mind. It was someone other than herself. She wrote, quote, I can't help thinking that what he really won't be powerful, drawn to, was a woman very strong, very upright, a fighter, a lofter, well-experienced, a black woman. I kept seeing her as, unquote. Just Google the Vanity Fair article and read about Barack Obama's white girlfriend. She explains also about President Obama's dream of going to Kenya. The Lotus Sutra explains Buddhist teachings show us how Barack Obama was looking for Michelle Robinson, and their relationship is a matter of karma. No, it was no accident or happenstance. All one has to do is examine the background and of Barack Obama Jr. and that of Michelle Robinson, and you would see that this was a marriage made in heaven, as Buddhism explains. The writer of the movie Southside with You, Richard Taney, did not come anywhere close to explaining the real or comic relationship of Barack and Michelle Obama. Perhaps the Obama story will be told. Their daughter, Malia, who has an interest in filmmaking, perhaps she will tell the Buddhist and the accurate story of the Obama. For white people in America who listen to this lecture, what I want to convey to you, and you may not get this from nobody else, but what you must understand, that being black in America is a choice. You see, if you want to get a clearer understanding of Barack Obama Jr., you must understand that Barack Obama Jr. made a choice to be black in America. You'd also find that Michelle Robinson, who later became Michelle Obama, made a choice to be black in America. You see, all people of African descent are all black people. Some of us are black by culture, and some of us are black by choice. Now, let me give you an example. Barack Obama was born in 1961. Now, there's also an African American who was born in 1961 by the name of Allen West. Now, Alan West is a congressman from Florida. Now, he was interviewed by CNN News, and CNN News asked this African-American congressman, what does Black History Month mean to him? And this is what Alan West wrote. In light of this month being Black History Month, I feel no way involved with this Negro celebration of half accomplishments and borderline communist agendas. View of the list of these fearless leaders of Black America, Black inhabitants knew their place at the table and knew they could not eat off the same plate of the more than welcoming white men and women of the time. These men, I use the term lightly, like Malcolm X, pushed themselves into the homes of innocent white Americans. This action riled up the Negro and scared the living hell out of people. I am no way apart from this community, a part of this community, transported Africans. I myself am an American. I'm a good old boy from the great state of Florida and a citizen of this nation. I know God recognized me as my true self, a proud, strong white man given dark pigmentation. God had to give the Black at least one intelligent person, so he chose to give me dark skin. I curse my birth as a Black man every day. I'm Black by birth, not by choice. It will all be sorted out when my name is called and I step in front of the great white Jesus himself, unquote. Now, this is a African-American congressman who hates that he is Black. He says he's Black by birth, not by choice. We can look at African-American Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas, who an example of one who is born Black, who choose not to be Black. Let me take you to the current and contemporary example of a man who choose to be Black in America. Now, San Francisco quarterback Colin Kaepernick made the decision to be Black in America based on his actions of not standing for the national anthem. Kaepernick, whose mother is white and father is African American, was raised as a white in America, is quoted as saying, I am not going to stand up and show pride in a flag for a country that oppresses Black people and people of color. He explained, to me, this is bigger than football. It would be selfish on my part to look the other way. There are bodies in the street and people getting paid leave and getting away with murder, unquote. Now, on September the 5th, 2016, President Obama, during the G20 summit in China, said that he supports 49ers quarterbacks' right to free speech. He's exercising his constitutional right to make a statement, Obama said. President Obama thinks that Kaepernick would refine how he's thinking about it, and maybe some critics we'll see he has a point around justice and equality. Sometimes it's messy, but that's how democracy works. Unquote. Now, the Obamas have not officially commented on the movie. However, as a proud Black Buddhist, we can say that there are relationships, there are dates, and there are relationships that are destiny. we hold that the Obama relationship was not just a date, but it was destiny. Now, in the Buddhist writings called the Gosho, this is what the Buddhist teachings explains about a Barack Obama or a ruler of a nation. On page 328, the Gosho is called Pure and Far-Reaching Voice Reads. And this is Nichiren Shonin. He's quoted as saying, quote, "The ruler of a state is someone who, in his former existence, far excelled others in keeping the great precepts. And as a result, heaven and earth and various deities permitted him to become a ruler. The degree of merit he has acquired through keeping the precepts determine what country he rules. Two or three persons are not chosen to be a ruler, but only one. The deity kings of earth and heaven, of the oceans and mountains, all gather around and protect him." Unquote. See, we hold that President Barack Obama became president of our nation because of past causes he made in a former existence. We also hold that his beloved wife, the former Michelle Robinson, was destined to be his wife. While I enjoyed the movie, we hold that the movie gave only a superficial understanding of the Obama relationship. The movie only dealt with one day of the Obama relationship, while our lecture is a Buddhist thesis. In short, the Lotus Sutra teaches us that all phenomena manifest its true entity. Now, we explain that the lotus blooms in the swamp or the dirt. Out of the hood in Chicago, the Obamas emerge. Now, the Gosho entity of the mystic law reads, quote, "These two aspects, the deluded and the enlightened, are indeed two different phenomena, yet both are workings of the one principle, that is, the essential nature of phenomena, or the true aspect of reality. It is like a piece of crystal. If the crystal is placed in the sun's rays, it will attract them and produce fire. But if it is placed in the moon's rays, it will produce water. The crystal is a single entity, but the effect it produces differ according to the circumstances. The mystic principle of the true aspect of reality is like this. The mystic principle of the true aspect of reality is one. But if it encounters evil influences, it will manifest delusion, while if it encounters good influences, it will manifest enlightenment. Enlightenment means enlightenment to the essential nature of phenomena, and delusion is ignorance of it." Unquote. Now, the encounter of Barack Obama Jr. meeting Michelle Robinson is what led to he becoming America's first black president and she becoming America's first black lady. The Lotus Sutra 10 aspects again are appearance, nature, entity, power, influence, inherent cause, relationship, latent effect, manifest effect, and a consistency beginning to the end. The inherent cause and relationship produced a latent effect that led to a manifest effect of America's first black president and first lady. Now, we at the Proud Black Buddhist World Association hold that Barack Obama Jr. and Michelle Robinson, they never had a date, but they had a destiny. Another word for destiny is karma. We challenge you to do an in-depth study on the background of Barack Obama Jr., Michelle Robinson, and you will realize that this is a relationship made in heaven. Everything about this whole thing is perfect. Let me quote a phrase from the Ghost Show, Entity of the Mystic Law again. The mystic principle of true aspect of reality is like this. The mystic principle of true aspect of reality is one, but if it encounters evil influences, it will manifest delusion, while if it encounters good influences, it will manifest enlightenment, unquote. Now, what is the point of the Buddhist religion? The point is to encounter good influences. See, when we encounter good influences, we manifest enlightenment, but when we encounter bad influences, we manifest delusion. The Obama-Robinson relationship was a self-generated trajectory where the two met good influences. Let me have a little fun with the Richard Tanya movie strip. There is one thing that I learned about black women in America. The best woman that could function with a black man is a black woman who loves and respects her father. Now, Barack Obama had already won Michelle before he ever begun because of the love and respect she has for her father. She's a different kind of woman. Now, let us go back to 1989 with a 28-year-old Barack Obama Jr. who arrived at the Sydney Austin Law Firm. This is the sixth largest corporate law firm in America. The 28-year-old Barack Obama Jr. who came to the firm as an associate was a star. He was a prodigy. This was an experienced 28-year-old man who was motivated and focused. There is no way in the hell I could see a Barack Obama being the whip that he was projected in the movie. Let's, first of all, take a look at a scene for the movie. And what I see as a character is nothing like the Barack Obama I know. Let's take a scene from the movie and we're going to come back and put a period on this lecture. Let's look at the scene from the movie.
There's heat. Hey, Chicago, what are you doing to keep cool?
Michelle
thought it wasn't a date.
It isn't.
Going to an awful lot of trouble for just another smooth talking brother.
He's the summer associate I told y'all about, the one from Harvard Law. He invited me to a community event.
So what's this boy's name?
Barack Obama.
Barack Obama.
Hi.
Hello.
You're late.
I was hoping you wouldn't notice.
I expected it. You were late for your first day of work.
You noticed that too.
I'm your advisor. I'm supposed to notice.
Well, Michelle, all set?
Shouldn't we be getting to the meeting?
We have some time. I thought we'd swing by the art center, see some paintings, maybe grab a bite to eat.
This is not a date. How's it gonna look if I start dating the first cute black guy who walks through the firm's doors? It would be tacky.
You think I'm cute?
I didn't say that. You can tell by the smile. So why did you come to Chicago?
To try and make a difference.
Thought I would too. Maybe I'd help women, empower them.
You and I share a lot of the same interests.
That's sweet of you, but I'm an ice cream kind of girl.
Who doesn't like pie?
This Barack's woman, Michelle.
Finally a sister.
We're not together. Pretty good setting to bring a girl surrounded by people who adore you.
We gotta stop thinking no is the end of the line. You flip those letters around, you get an entirely different word. On, as in carry on.
And an inspirational speech that had everybody in awe.
Stay with me now. They say no, we say carry on. She
is so sweet. It's been a while since I've had that kind of connection to real life struggle. Just want to do more.
Yeah, so do I. I wonder if I can write books or hold a position of influence in civil rights.
Politics?
Maybe.
You want some?
Sure.
Smooth, don't you?
And real cute.
I mean, they did look good on Dumbo.
You see a scene from the movie. There is no way that I could see the relationship of Barack and a Michelle Obama as it's projected in the movie Southside with you. The idea of Barack Obama being a wimp. For example, he comes up, he says, oh, you're late, I expected it. You were late for your first day on the job. That is the writing of Mr. Richard Tiny. In real life, if you read about Michelle Obama and Barack Obama, she thought and she had heard about this young law associate from Harvard, who was 28 years old. She had heard about him. What was interesting about him, he was so phenomenal that the law firm doesn't usually hire a first-year law student, but he was so fantastic that the law firm hired him. And Michelle, when she imagined him to be a nerd. Now, when you look at a Barack Obama at 28 years old, articulate, father from Kenya, raised in Indonesia, grew up in Hawaii, man, that's intriguing, articulate, a confident brother. What you would have there is a natural relationship. And anybody who was in an office always have said they always liked each other. Now, there is no way I can see Barack Obama being a wimp. Now, my thing is not to criticize the movie. However, I cannot see Barack Obama Jr. coming to the home of a Michelle Robinson and not coming inside to meet and talk to her parents. As a black man, I can tell you how the movie is wrong. If you are Barack Obama, and you handsome, articulate, and you 28 years old, you are gonna come inside, and you are gonna charm the mother, and you are gonna make a bond with the father, and you are going to get the blessings of the family. Now, in real life, imagine a Barack Obama. Now, by my being a black man who has lived life, who has dated attorneys, or who would have dated someone like a Michelle Obama, if you got that much going for you, sister girl, her friends would say, girl, you going out with this handsome guy, a woman like that would love to show you off. The idea that he had to trick her and going to a date at an art museum, are you kidding? To go to an art museum, something intelligent, that you got to understand, ladies and gentlemen, what we must note here is that Barack Obama is black by choice. And Michelle Robinson was black by choice. Let me explain. She majored in sociology, and her minor was black history. So she already had a sense of culture, a sense of black pride. And for her to meet someone like Barack Obama, who was a law associate, someone who's intelligent, someone who had worked in community relations. Now, you got to realize her father was a Democratic Party precinct captain. The family was connected in politics. She went to school and she was best friends with, I think, Santita Jackson, Jesse Jackson's daughter. This woman was connected, more connected than he was. So they were more alike, but the idea of this imbalance to where he has to go and win a date. What we say, that they didn't have a date, they had a destiny, and somewhere in the future when a movie is made about Barack and Michelle Obama, you're going to find that they had a karma and they had a destiny. This is what Buddhism teach. Now, let me speak a bit as a black filmmaker. In 1988, Barack Obama traveled to Kenya prior to him starting law school. Now, his going to Kenya allowed him to resolve issues he had with his father. In 1988, my movie premiered, and in 1989, the city of Memphis honored Kenya. And in 1988, I found myself honoring Kenyans at the time that Barack and Michelle Obama had met to go see the movie Do the Right Thing. Now, in 1953, that's the year of my birth, a civil rights organization emerged called ACOA, or the American Committee on Africa. ACOA was founded by a gay African American by the name of Bayard Rustin and a white man by the name of George Hauser. On August 15, 1956, a 26-year-old African by the name of Tom and Boyer arrived from what was then known as British East Africa. And Boyer, while booked to speak at colleges in America, asked colleges to award scholarships for African students. And Boyer negotiated air travel for African students. The Boyer program was so successful that a chartered flight bringing African students to America happened in 1959. In fact, it was singer Harry Belafonte, baseball great Jackie Robinson, and actor Sidney Poitier who signed their names to a letter to pay for a chartered flight so Kenyans, not Kenyans, they weren't Kenyans at the time, so Africans could come to America for an education. And in 1959, a young Kenyan, wasn't Kenyan, but now a young African from British East Africa by the name of Barack Obama Sr. came to school in Hawaii. Now, the Lotus Sutra teaches us that all phenomena manifest its true entity. Let's go back to 1953. In the same year that a core of the American Committee on Africa emerged, this was what? As Buddhism teach, an appearance, a nature, an entity, a power, an influence, an inherent cause, a relationship, a latent effect, a manifest effect, and the consistency of beginning to the end. We relate the 10 aspects or the 3,000 worlds and a momentary state of existence directly to Barack Obama Jr. and Michelle Robinson getting to Kenya in 1992. See, a core about 26-year-old Tom and Boyer from British East Africa on August 15th, 1956. Emboria's efforts led to 23-year-old Barack Obama Sr. coming to school in Hawaii, which led to Barack Obama Jr., who met a Michelle Robinson, whom he took to Kenya in 1992. Now, also, it was Tom Emboria who convinced a John F. Kennedy, a presidential candidate, in 1960 to fund air travel so African students could come to America to get an education. This led to African Americans joining the Democratic Party because this is how Kennedy got influence, because by him having African students, African Americans moved from Republican to Democrat, which led to the Obama or Michelle Robinson daddy becoming a Democrat. So there is an interrelationship between life and phenomena. Now, Michelle, as we said, majored in sociology and minored in black studies. Her close friend was Jesse Jackson's daughter. Now, Michelle Robinson was well connected in the Chicago political sphere. Now, there's a name that worked in the law firm named Newton Minow. Now, he was the senior counsel in the Sydney Austin Chicago office, who is referred to in the movie where they meet at the movie Do the Right Thing. Now, it was he and his wife whom they met at the movie. Now, the real story is they sat together in the movie and there were no issues of them being embarrassed. In fact, the relationship was encouraged and respected. See, a Barack Obama and a Michelle, that relationship is a relationship of karma, which would have the blessings of all. Now, the movie Southside with You is considered charming, witty, and heartwarming. This movie comes nowhere near the true depth and understanding of the Obama relationship. We hold that only the Lotus Sutra, a true Buddhism, explains the Obama relationship. Barack Obama Jr. is the most unique African American on planet Earth. Now, he is the most unique not because he is the first black president in America's history. Barack Obama Jr. is the most unique African American in American history because he connects Africans, Americans, and African Americans. Now, in the upcoming issue of Essence Magazine, this is in October of 2016, this is what Michelle Obama is quoted as saying, quote, "I think when it comes to black kids, it means something for them to have spent most of their life seeing the family in the White House black who look like them." Miss Obama said, "It matters. All future work that Barack talked about, I think over the last few years, we've kind of knocked the ceiling of limitation off the roots of many young kids, imaginations of what's possible for them. As a mother, I wouldn't underestimate how important that is. Having that wisdom that you can really do some anything, not because somebody told you, but because you see and experience it, I think that will be a lasting impact on our kids." Unquote. In regards to the movie Southside with You, myself, as a black filmmaker, would have wrote a movie whereas we tell the Buddhist aspect of a Obama relationship, whether in a movie or on the big screen. Social media gives us the opportunity to publish about the Obama relationship from a black perspective. If I was doing such a movie, I would show providence. I want you to look into the lives. Do you realize that one person can change your life or shape your destiny? You can meet a soulmate and change your destiny, or you can meet a common mortal and become a master of mediocrity. The movie of Barack and Michelle Obama that will happen in the future of the two soulmates meeting and changing the destiny of a nation. In the future, it will show the Buddhism. It will show that this relationship with those happenstance. Let me bring this lecture Southside with You home. I want you to look at a picture of my actual home. As you see, I have the first all-African house in America. Now, you see on my home a billboard and a picture of the matriarch of the Obama family, Sarah Obama. Sarah Obama is the grandmother to President Barack Obama Jr. I want you to see a photograph of Michelle Obama in Kenya in 1992. I was in Kenya about the same time that Barack Obama Jr. and Michelle Robinson was in Kenya. In 1992, I met Kenyan President Daniel Arap Moi. It is only the Lotus Sutra that explains life in terms of 3,000 worlds in a momentary state of existence and the interrelatedness of life and mutuality. Let us go back to the movie Southside with you and our Black Buddhist lecture. This is how Dr. Martin Luther King describes it. And he said this, I think, from a letter from Birmingham Jail. He says, quote, "In a sense, all life is interrelated. All men are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly," unquote. That, my friend, is the Lotus Sutra of the true Buddhist religion. We chant Namu Myoho Renge Kyo. Again, Namu means to awaken. Myo means correct, open, incomprehensible, wonderful. Ho means the law of the 3,000 worlds and a momentary state of existence. Renge means cause and effect, as symbolized by the lotus flower. Kyo means teachings. In short, what is Buddhism is awakening or to open to the wonderful, incomprehensible, universal law of cause and effect teachings. Let us bring this lecture to a close. In 1990, I went to Kenya while at Masai Mara. I sat in a tent and I cried tears. I realized that my ancestors had come from Africa and I was among the first to return. My ancestors admonished me to tell African Americans to come home to Mother Africa. My life is dedicated to bringing us Africans home. From the time I returned from Africa in 1990, my life has not been the same. I dedicated my life to helping to bring African Americans home to Africa. For a decade, I took groups to Kenya. In 1992, I met Kenyan President Daniel Arap Moi. Also in 1992, Memphis elected its first African-American mayor, Dr. W.W. Harrington. I spent about 18 years trying to get this mayor to connect Memphis and Kenya. In 2008, I was at a Christmas party at my friend, and the mayor and I had words. I told Mayor Harrington that while I was unable to connect to Kenya and Africa, we have a president whose father was from Kenya. In 2009, I sent President Obama an African-style tuxedo, hoping he would wear the tuxedo for his inauguration. Eventually, I got a thank you letter from the White House from President Obama. In 2009, when President Obama went to Ghana, Congressman Steve Cohen mentioned our work on the floor of Congress. I've met with many ambassadors over the years, and I've been trying to bring Africans and African Americans together. In 2013, I traveled to the Obama family hometown of Kogalo, Kenya, where I met the matriarch, Sarah Obama, grandmother to Barack Obama. Grandmother Sarah Sarah, her words was,
"Thank you, Grandma."
She said that she was my grandmother also. I asked her would she come to America and help spread the word of us African Americans coming home. And she agreed. The Obama story was not a date, but a destiny. The movie Southside with You was a great movie. And in my life, the movie was more. 2018 marks the 50th anniversary of the death of Dr. Martin Luther King in Memphis. We are creating a movement to ask President Obama to come to Memphis for Dr. King's 50th. We are not only asking President Obama to come to Memphis, we're asking Kenyan President Uhuru Kenyatta to come to Memphis, as well as asking President Kenyatta to honor African Americans with a formal state reception in 2019. When the presidents come to Memphis, we're asking them to visit this home. This home is located in what was known as the John George Dedrick Plantation, later a neighborhood called Orange Mound, the first black neighborhood built by African Americans in the United States. This is Orange Mound, where we live, the first neighborhood built by African Americans. If you visit our home, you'll see a billboard and a picture of me in Kogolo, Kenya, Kenya, the Obama home in Kenya. Also, you see me with Grandma Sarah Obama. We have the first African-style home. Our dream is to bring Africans and African Americans together and bring America closer to Africa. So, the movie Southside with you was not just a movie, but it was a destiny. And our destiny is all interrelated. I am Anthony L. Elmore, President and Founder of the Proud Black Buddhist World Association. Thank you very much.
Self-development and enlightenment. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. I pray the Lord will suit your way, the way that I pray. Overcome my sins. I say the Lord's title again and again. I get down on my knees and I pray. Every day, I pray the Lord will suit your way. The Lord will suit your past the test. The Lord will suit you, brings me happiness. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. I pray the Lord will suit your way. Falling in the Lord will suit you. I start to sing, I sing so loud, I start to scream. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. And I pray the Lord will suit your way. I don't pray like my Eastern brother. I pray and sing with my own culture. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. And I pray the Lord will suit your way. I pray the way that I feel. I pray the black way and I start to squeal. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. And I pray the Lord will suit your way. There's one thing you must know about me. I get like the church folk and I get happy. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. And I pray the Lord will suit your way. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. And I pray, and I pray, I pray. pray. Don't notice how I pray. I pray.